Nathan MacKinnon just signed the biggest AAV contract in NHL history to cap off a year that included winning the Stanley Cup and cementing himself as a top five player in the world. In many ways, MacKinnon's path to this moment has always felt like destiny. But as we all know, the actual path to success is never that simple. This is MacKinnon's path to today and how he emerged from Sidney Crosby's shadow. Nathan Raymond MacKinnon was born on September 1st, 1995 in the town of Halifax, Nova Scotia, and he lived in the nearby town of Cole Harbour. Before we get into MacKinnon, we do need to talk about Nova Scotia. Nova Scotia is, of course, part of Canada, so hockey is a huge part of their culture. But the Canadian Maritimes are much less populated than many parts of Canada, and in general have far fewer successful NHLers than places like Ontario. When you look at the list of players from Nova Scotia, you really only get a couple of dozen players that had successful NHL careers, and high-impact players you can count on one hand. That, of course, includes Nathan MacKinnon, but suffice to say, it's kind of a big deal that he's such a big success there, and kind of crazy that he's not even the best player from his hometown. Before MacKinnon could even think about playing hockey professionally, there was this kid named Sidney Crosby breaking pretty much every minor junior kid league record there was in the Nova Scotia area. For MacKinnon, Crosby was the forerunner of his entire pre-professional career. People started to realize MacKinnon might be kind of a big deal pretty early on when in Adam under 11s, he put up 200 points in 50 games. When people started to realize Cole Harbour might have another superstar on his hands, the path was already laid out. MacKinnon was going to go to Shattuck St. Mary's. He was going to get drafted first overall into the QMJHL, where he would dominate and ultimately become the first overall pick in the NHL. All of this did come to pass, but it was never quite as assured as many people think. Early on, there was never any doubt the similarities between MacKinnon and Crosby. He did go to Shattuck St. Mary's prep for hockey and even picked up the same training coach in Andy O'Brien. Already a great skater at that young age, it was O'Brien who helped morph him into one of the best skaters in the world. At Shattuck, MacKinnon was great, playing against players up to 5 years older than him at times, but he wasn't as good as Crosby, and you're going to hear a lot of that in this video. After 2 years at Shattuck St. Mary's, MacKinnon was eligible for the QMJHL draft, where he did go first overall, but it was an interesting situation. In fact, on the day of the draft, MacKinnon was skating with the Omaha Lancers and was considering going through the USHL and the NCAA route. This is largely because the first overall pick was to buy Como Dracar. It being the QMJHL, it's no big surprise that many of the teams were from Quebec, including by Como, and there was a lot of French-speaking teams. The problem here, Nathan MacKinnon didn't speak any French. One of the many what-ifs of this world is what if Nathan MacKinnon didn't end up getting into the QMJHL. But thankfully, Halifax realized they had a hometown hero on their hands and didn't want to miss out like they did with Crosby. In a massive trade, they acquired the rights to Nathan MacKinnon, and with an English-speaking team, MacKinnon was willing to sign with the QMJHL. MacKinnon would debut with the Halifax Mooseheads that season and was scoring goals before he was even allowed to legally drive. with a September 1st birthday, he was one of the youngest players in his draft class, and actually makes a lot of his feats even more impressive. It didn't take very long for MacKinnon to adjust to the major junior level either. Just 2 months into his QMJHL career, he was doing things like having a 5-goal game and single-handedly beating teams. There was little doubt that he was dominant and one of the best players not just in the Q, but in all of junior hockey. All of this quality, all of this praise, and despite all that, he wasn't even really that close to putting up the type of numbers that Sidney Crosby did. But where MacKinnon really began to shine was the playoffs, and this is going to be a theme throughout his entire career. When the stakes step up, so does MacKinnon. Across two QMJHL seasons, MacKinnon put up 61 points in 34 playoff games, including helping the Halifax Mooseheads to a QMJHL championship, and then leading them to a Mem Cup championship as well. As a 6'200" player at not even the age of 18, MacKinnon was simply bigger, faster, and stronger than all of his competition. Stylistically, he and Crosby aren't even that similar. MacKinnon, bigger, able to outmuscle players, also an unbelievably good skater, beat people with his explosiveness and strength. Crosby, a much more intelligent player and extremely gifted with natural talent and his ability to use his skill, Nathan MacKinnon had plenty of that, but got around the ice differently, played much more instinctually, and whereas Crosby had maybe one of the best hockey minds ever, in my opinion, MacKinnon was just sheer, raw, unbridled force. While with the Mooseheads, MacKinnon's career had already started to transcend hockey. He would appear in a Canadian TV show called Mr. D, playing himself, a student who was struggling in class but constantly getting out to go play hockey. No, I didn't make that up. This is a real thing that aired on Canadian TV, and he showed up in multiple episodes basically doing the same thing. This would also last into his NHL career, as he would continue to do cameos and acting, even on shows that Americans might recognize, like Trailer Park Boys. So MacKinnon was one of the leading prospects going into his NHL draft, coming off of that Mem Cup victory. But at the time, there was no guarantee he would even go first overall. Sasha Barkov was doing record-level things for teenagers over in the Liga. You had Seth Jones as the consensus number one D-man in the draft, and you even had MacKinnon's running mate, Jonathan Drouin, in the conversation at the top. The Colorado Avalanche held the first overall pick in the 2013 draft. And if you remember back to that 5-goal game I mentioned a couple of minutes ago in the QMJHL, the coach on the opposing bench in that game was Patrick Waugh. The very same Patrick Waugh who, at the 2013 NHL draft, was the Colorado Avalanche's vice president of hockey operations. Waugh had seen MacKinnon's unbridled fury firsthand, and there was no way he was going to pass it up.
The Colorado Avalanche are proud to select with our first pick from the Halifax Mooseheads, Nathan MacKinnon.
There was no doubt about MacKinnon's greatness at the junior level, even if it wasn't the generational caliber of someone like Sidney Crosby. But getting drafted first overall in the NHL doesn't just come with expectations. Players like that need to be great out of necessity. The Avs spent the last half decade trying and failing to complete a rebuild where they made the playoffs just once. It wasn't said in so many words, but really, MacKinnon was being brought in to be the savior of the franchise, the next great one for them. And in his rookie season, Nathan MacKinnon absolutely lived up to the hype. With 63 points in 82 games, Nathan MacKinnon cemented himself as a core piece alongside other big Avalanche pieces in Matt Duchene, Gabe Landeskog, Ryan O'Reilly, and Paul Stastny. It really is incredible to think how deep the Avs were at center at that time. With MacKinnon's scoring getting added to that bunch, it brought the Avs not just back to the playoffs, but to, at the time, their best season in franchise history. And while the Avs ultimately went on to lose in the first round of the playoffs in 7 games that year, Nathan MacKinnon was electric in the playoffs once again. With 10 points in 7 games that year, including a couple of incredible clutch goals, MacKinnon is just a different animal when it comes down to it. Some might even call him the dog. MacKinnon seemed to be on track for the near immediate success in the NHL that also came to Crosby. That wasn't to be the case at all, though. Over the next 3 years, the Colorado Avalanche struggled and missed the playoffs over that time, and Nathan MacKinnon went the same way. Failing to live up to his rookie season in any of that time, MacKinnon kind of struggled to find his place in the Avalanche lineup. Now, granted, the Colorado Avalanche were all over the place as a team as well, so that certainly had an effect on it, and especially when you look at the 16-17 season, where the Avalanche were the worst team in modern history, Nathan MacKinnon putting up 53 points that year is actually pretty good. But 4 years into his career, Nathan MacKinnon was absolutely not the superstar everyone hoped he could be, and people were starting to question what exactly his ceiling was. Because of those weak performances, MacKinnon ended up signing a $6.3 million contract deal with the Avs, and in just a few short years, that would likely be the best contract in the NHL. When 17-18 rolled around, things changed for Colorado. MacKinnon, now part of the leadership group and wearing an A, we finally saw the departure of Matt Duchene, and really the majority of the Avs' key core from when MacKinnon first started was gone. Now, if you ask me, regardless of the players around him that season, MacKinnon would have broken out anyway. But without those players, there was no one else. MacKinnon had to be the man. Over the course of that season, the ascent for MacKinnon finally happened. Putting up 97 points in just 74 games, MacKinnon had reached that superstar status. The Avs would again be eliminated in the first round of the playoffs, but MacKinnon, a point-per-game player in those playoffs once again. He would follow that season up by silencing any of the doubters left with a 99-point regular season and taking the Avs back to the second round of the playoffs for the first time in over a decade. From that point on, dominance became the norm for MacKinnon. The only thing preventing him from multiple 100-point seasons was a global pandemic. The playoffs have seen MacKinnon continue to be unbelievably dominant, and he now sits in the top five all time in NHL playoff points per game scoring. It's truly one of the best players ever in the playoffs. With that being said, through 2021, there was a little bit of a reputation starting to form. To that point in his career, Nathan MacKinnon had never made it out of the second round, and was 0-for-3 in Game 7s with 0 points. There was a bit of a stigma starting to form that MacKinnon couldn't get a team over the hump. Now, if you paid any attention, you know that that reputation was pretty darn undeserved, even if there were some not great Game 7s in there. Through much of the career of MacKinnon, he was single-handedly dragging the Avs through these playoff games, and nearly got them there by himself. Okay, that might be a bit of an exaggeration. He did have Mikko Rantanen and Gabe Landeskog and some others around him. But truly, Nathan MacKinnon had actually been a major impact player for the Avs in the playoffs. And that brings us to this season, where MacKinnon's dominance continued. And you know what? He figured if he's not good at Game 7s, just don't play one. True greatness has to be sustained, and that's exactly what MacKinnon has done over the last 5 years, finally being rewarded for it and reaching the pinnacle of the NHL this season. And for any nitpickers of Nate's playoff performance and his level of clutch, he not only scored the game-tying goal in Game 6 of the Cup Finals, he assisted on the game-winning goal. Today, Nathan MacKinnon is the best Colorado Avalanche player post-lockout. Now, Cale Makar does exist, so we'll see how things play out. But Nathan MacKinnon's story of success has been living up to the hype in pretty much every imaginable way. And honestly, that Stanley Cup helped free MacKinnon from Sidney Crosby and all of the comparisons. They'll still get compared. They still should be compared to a certain extent. But the media often likes to build it up as a rivalry, when in reality, that just isn't the case. It's not two players competing to be the best player from Cole Harbour. In fact, the two of them are great friends. They train together, they work on their games together. Hell, they even did a commercial together. When the Avs were struggling and the Penguins were winning back-to-back championships, MacKinnon was the drunkest guy at Sidney Crosby's parade. This last season, when MacKinnon got his parade in Cole Harbour, Crosby returned the favor.
I'd say at least top five. At least.
And sure, there is a little bit of a competitive edge when they play each other. They want to be the best, make no mistake about it. But there's no hate here. I do want to take a look at each of the players' achievements, but just keep that in mind when you're looking at these things. We can take a look at MacKinnon's first. He has seen success at the international level at the World Championships. He has his Stanley Cup, as well as a Calder from his rookie year. He also got a Lady Bing that was mostly a sorry we snubbed you that we'll talk about in a second. When you compare that to Crosby's list, MacKinnon does have two trophies in his case that Crosby doesn't. A Calder and a Lady Bing. And while Crosby does have significantly more hardware, this conversation is actually closer than you might think. Yes, the obvious, MacKinnon is two cups short and it doesn't have a Conn Smythe yet. Crosby does have the two Hart trophies, but you'll remember MacKinnon was almost certainly snubbed once in the one that Taylor Hall won where he came in second, and he also came second place in voting a secondary time a few years later. So you're just a handful of votes away from MacKinnon having just as many hearts. He also has two Olympic gold medals, but those aren't really fair because MacKinnon hasn't been allowed to play at the Olympics. Crosby is an eight-time All-Star, whereas MacKinnon right now has only been twice. His Art Rosses and his Rocket Richard trophies. But here's the key note. Crosby is 35. MacKinnon is only 27. Realistically, MacKinnon is just hitting the prime of his career. And while I can't see the future, there are plenty of opportunities for him to earn a ton more hardware. There is no doubt, whenever Crosby retires, he is an instant first ballot Hall of Famer. And Nathan MacKinnon is on that track as well. The fact that both of these players are from the same town in Nova Scotia will leave them forever linked, constantly compared and always talked about together. But the reality is, they're both their own separate players, and MacKinnon's success, finally getting to the top of that mountain in the NHL, has shown that separation. As Crosby starts to age out of the league, there will be other generational players, McDavid and others, around to pick up that mantle. But Nathan MacKinnon has already created a mantle of his own. When it's all said and done, I think Sidney Crosby is probably going to be the better player. But both of these guys will be in the Hall of Fame, and MacKinnon will be an all-timer all by himself. You can let Sid be the kid and let Nate be the dog. Which brings us back to Nathan MacKinnon's contract. We have the pleasure of watching eight more years of Nathan MacKinnon and his dominance. If those years hold even half of what Crosby's years from 27 to 35 did, it will be an absolute blast.